man. What's happening?
Not enough to see. Thank you all for being here. This is one of my favorite films of the year. Congratulations on it. It's so great. It's so great. Ladies first, I feel like that's the right way to go. Divine, Lady Reed is a phenomenal, phenomenal person in this film. There's so much going on with her. She is regal in every sense, but it sort of seems like obviously Rudy Ray Moore is instrumental in letting her know that. I'm wondering what were some of the keys to you in kind of figuring her out and where she kind of was in this world.
First of all, thank you very much. That's very kind of you to say. You know what's interesting? I have to be honest with you, there's nothing on her. It was going to be really straightforward. There's nothing on her. So as an actor approaching this project, at first I was nervous because I was worried like, Eddie or Greg will think like she didn't do her homework, she doesn't care, you know? So what I did was, at Yale they have a department called dramaturgy. And so it's kind of like, they're like the historians of theater. And so what'll happen is when you do, I see it predominantly more so in plays. When you do a play, they know everything that they need to know about the world of that play. So I thought that they do that for everything. They don't. And so I had called one of my classmates and I was like, I can't find anything, but you know, if you're like FBI skills, can you, you know, detect and see if there's any information on her? And there wasn't. And so that's really sad, that there are so many unsung heroes within many different cultures, but in particular with the African-American culture that we ourselves just don't even know about. And so for me, my main resource was limited to, but was a phenomenal resource, was I watched all the movies because I hadn't seen them before. I watched all of them. And to get a bit, I mean, she's acting, but you still, because she's a new actor, you see more of herself than she knows that she's showing. So that was very helpful. And then her party albums. And I would play them. Oh, it was The Voice. The Voice was my biggest way in, and you can tell a lot about a voice the way that, you know, they have people who analyze signatures. You can tell a lot about a voice, the emotion and when she meant it or when she was joking or, oops, she was a little bit vulnerable and said a little bit too much. So that really was my biggest way in to get a grasp of her personality. And also, ironically enough, through her clothing, because her clothing let me know that she was proud and loved herself, whether that was an ongoing journey or not. And so that was a huge thing that I was like, oh, this is not a timid woman. Like, she truly is full in every sense of the word. Yeah, not apologetic.
Yeah, force to be reckoned.
Force to be reckoned with, absolutely.
Force to be reckoned with.
That's a beautiful segue, obviously, to Ruth and your amazing costumes. You have
brought yes. Yeah.
From the 40s to the 60s in films like Malcolm X. You have created, obviously, the Warriors of Wakanda in Black Panther.
Yes.
But the amazing costumes here, I feel like they kind of have to do, as David, I was talking about, like some emotional work as well, because they have to be of the era, but not too heightened. They have to be fun, but not comical. And they sort of have to, like Rudy Ray Moore, kind of take themselves seriously in a way. What were some of the approaches that you wanted to take, or kind of the ways in for you?
Well, the first approach was my instinct after reading the script. I was a child in the 70s. I remembered it very well. I remember things I wore. I have five brothers and two sisters. I remembered what they looked like. And it ran the gamut from, you know, the Black Panthers and the residual of that, you know, and the Afro and the hippie look and, you know, the urban dandy, you know, the pimp look. And so I remembered everything, and I wanted my crew to really understand that we weren't going to make a mockery. We weren't doing a 70s party movie that, you know, everybody could be laughed at and pointed at. We were actually going to try to give the film a great a baseline of real looks and real people. And so I looked at a lot of, I looked at all of the films. Larry and Scott gave us a lot of background research that they had done, a lot of black and white photographs of the crew working to make Dolomite, I think a Dolomite film. That was very helpful in sharing with my crew that, you know, we're making this a realistic depiction of what was going on in the world of the 70s. And it also laid a nice framework for giving these larger than life characters, a platform so that Rudy Ray Moore could actually be even bigger than the 70s was, and or Dolomite could be, because this was a character that he created. And also the theatrical aspect of it was very important because, you know, they were performing in the film and they were working behind the scenes, and so I really wanted to have the feel, the sense that, you know, they may have performed in a scene and therefore they were in costume at times. So it was really fun to balance between, you know, what the world of the 70s was, and that we weren't going to make fun of it. We were going to actually try to give it as realistic of a depiction as possible so we could elevate these characters, and this drama troupe could have a look all of its own. And I think the film did that.
Yeah. Absolutely. Is so funny in his exasperation, and also so perfectly attuned to obviously
inappropriate.
But so perfectly attuned to obviously that he has standards. This comes from a very important place in him, and he recognizes that even these well-meaning amateurs need to have.
Well, Pilgrim Martin studied classical theater at the Sorbonne, and over at Lincoln Center there, where he was a great professor in his dreams, a couple of dreams.
It's all about the presentation.
The auteur director who is struggling, who unfortunately is caught in being an actor.
The moment I love too, though, is that when he says to Rudy, that he gives him a little bit of inspiration, and he's talking about John Cassavetes, and he's saying, this is a dude that you need to use that. There's obviously this connection there where he's pretty on this front a little bit, but he also has things to offer, and he wants to make sure Rudy gets them, right? Is that, or something he's to him for you, and kind of besides that great bit that you just did now of that sort of front that he's presenting to the world?
In the character?
Yeah, I figure.
Oh, just referencing people I know.
Yep.
Aspirational directors, they're those from the classical training schools of theater and Juilliard. I know a lot of it.
Yeah.
And then, you know, I drew from the 70s, like our other great masters over here. And I was excited about being able to wear clothes that I couldn't afford in those days if I put them on.
And a great exit line. I don't think I've seen one like that in the last few years. That's the perfect exit line. Was just sort of trying to go, walk away. A gesture of whatever.
If only they could have been up to Dermot Martin's standard.
That's right. Scott and Larry, so many of your scripts are so special, and Man on the Moon, and Wood, and People vs. Larry Flint involve not just obviously the dreams of oddballs and outsiders, but also how those dreams impact the people around them and elevate those dreams of those people that they didn't even know that they had. What was the origins of this script and how it came around?
This script is something we talked about with Eddie Murphy like 16 years ago. We got a phone call from our agent saying that Eddie wanted to meet us. And we were like, oh my God, Eddie Murphy wants to meet us. And we went over and we walked in, and Eddie just started doing lines from a film we wrote called Ed Wood. And he was just like ripping it, and he was doing all the characters, and we're kind of freaking out. And then he said, do you know who Rudy Ray Moore is? And it turns out Scott and I were huge Rudy Ray Moore fans. We were obsessed with him when we were in college, with more the VHS era than the actual when the films came out. But we just thought Rudy Ray Moore was amazing. And so we instantly knew, you know, the idea of Eddie Murphy playing Rudy Ray Moore was like such a delicious idea. And within a couple of days, we were actually in the room with the real Rudy Ray Moore. And hanging out with Rudy, and he came in dressed up as kind of Dolomite, the way he presents himself. And the cool thing was being able to spend a long time with him was that sort of faded after an hour, and you kind of could really see the guy underneath. And it really made an impression on us that Dolomite was indeed a character that he created. In the sense that was where the sort of the sweetness of the movie came out. Where in the sense we said that's why the movie's called Dolomite Is My Name. It is about a guy who is older and feels he can't, you know, he's worried that he's not never going to succeed, and by creating his character, he becomes, like he said in the movie, a superhero.
It's also like, in so many ways, almost like he's crossing all these boundaries in entertainment. They sort of like almost like vaudeville, where he's obviously distilling comedy albums, and he's distilling, you know, urban folklore, and he's disturbing, you know, characters that he's known, and he's bringing them all together, obviously, on film in a way that's, and then he's doing roadshow, and he's bringing his film around to city to city. He's really like sort of in some ways like this apex of 20th century entertainment in some ways, right?
Yeah, I mean, it is vaudeville. He ran away from home when he was a teenager, and then he just, you know, started just trying to break in, and, you know, he'd be the background dancer, he'd be the backup singer, and so he knew every element of showbiz, and it was really fun. Is if you watch his movies, all his movies stop at a certain point and just turn into a vaudeville show. And it'll be like 10 or 15 minutes, a lady comes out, she sings a ballad. And then five guys come out and they do a dance. Yeah. You know, and then an announcer will come out. And then an announcer comes out and then announces a comedian. And then you're like, what is happening here? It's like Rudy just like wanted to like give all his friends their moments.
Yeah, that generosity of spirit.
Yeah, and so he's just like, oh, you want to be in my movie? What do I have to do? You can just do your act. Yeah, so he was always sharing the spotlight with everyone around him. Yeah. And then, you mentioned Ed Wood and Larry Flint. It's like, all these people we like telling stories about have this, like, this passion to succeed, but they want to kind of bring everyone around them with them.
And like everyone around them may not even know that they had that same dream, no. But I love that they find it together all as a group, as a community.
Yeah, no, we talked about that a little bit because we both made Super 8 movies when we were kids. And when you make Super 8 movies when you're kids, it's like, you know, you're the person who wants to be the filmmaker or the actor, but you got to grab grandma. And you got to grab your friend down the street. And they don't give a shit at all. And you've all of a sudden, they're starring in a movie, but they're holding the lights. And so that weird sense of putting on a show.
Yeah, if my sister had a friend over, the friend now has to like hold the mic up.
Right.
Friend didn't even know that we were shooting a movie.
Right. Suddenly recruited into it. I mean, it's like a spy coming up and going down the house. But it's something that Scott and Larry just said reminds me of the great moment, obviously, when the team goes to the offices of Dimension Films. And they're obviously all in character, but it's something that refers to something that you just said, Ruth, which is that these obviously are characters that they're playing, but it also brings them a sense of power, it brings them a sense of familiarity to these guys, and these guys at Dimension just sort of accept it. They're just like, okay, this is how Rudy Ray Moore and his team are.
This is how he rules.
Yeah, let's talk about that team. That obviously, as I said, like the costume had to be so precise but not heightened, but in that moment, they also have to be exactly what Rudy wanted to project, right?
Yeah, exactly. You know, they were trying to be impressive. And Divine reminded me that was the first day of shooting.
Oh, wow.
And so I hadn't really gotten...
Was that really?
Yeah.
And as the group, I think that he had some scenes by himself,
yeah.
But that was as the cast, that was our first time. We all met each other.
Yeah, and so I hadn't really gotten my rhythm yet, you know, so I'm kind of, you know, running around every angle of this group, this troupe that's coming in dribs and drabs to the set to make sure that, you know, it all kind of works together. And I had that red bowler hat in my hand, and I looked I had drawn a blank on Titus. And I was like, he needs a hat. And I remember putting it on his head and Eddie just falling out laughing. And then I thought, was that a good laugh or a bad laugh? And then I was even more confused, but I let it go because I felt like, I kept thinking vaudeville when I saw them together. And even though it was way past those times, I felt like they had that sense of when you said, you know, it's like vaudeville. And that's what it was one of my favorite looks.
I forgot that was the first day for the group. I was there that day and I just remember stepping out on the sunset and seeing the group coming at me going, oh my god, this movie is so cool.
And it's also like a musical in some ways. When Craig Robinson is singing there with the team, they're singing the theme.
Amazing.
And Ruth, that sequence of them all dressed up also is obviously, that's depicting like another level of this entertainment angle, which is the music angle, right?
Yeah, the music had everything to do with kind of the spirit of like, you know, the set and how we were all working together like a team and a family. I mean, it was the hottest summer on record, I think, in Los Angeles. It was so super hot, you know, and everybody was in polyester. And wanted to wear their costume to the set, so we're lugging things, you know, to add to them just before they say roll. But, you know, it was amazing. I mean, even the great Wesley Snipes here, I feel like this was, you know, a debut for him. And I was really, you know, excited to go through the paces of character because we did Jungle Fever together. And, you know, back then we had fun with the clothes. So having fun with him. And he was kind of, someone said to me yesterday, he was like a metrosexual. I was like, whoa, in the 70s? Really? I mean.
You know, some of the cast were like that.
Yeah, they were.
Hey, man.
Yeah. And he just played it so well, so well.
That's how he was back in the day.
By the way, we mentioned it a couple times. Let's have a huge round of applause, please, for Eddie Murphy and Richard Craig Brewer.
Good.
He's very good in this film. And Dave, you mentioned the sound of her voice, which I think is so interesting, because Lady Reed's voice, I feel like when we first meet her at the bar at the beginning, she's obviously going through things. By the time we get to her at the end, she feels a little bit like she's found her voice in some ways, right? Let's talk about how you kind of modulated that a little bit, and including even science scenes that have no voice, like when you're rolling out of bed with the money, which is so phenomenal and so joyful and so terrifically exuberant.
Rolling on the bed with money is always
it's always
experience. I don't know if you've had that experience, but I'm telling you, it's a good thing. Try it, you go like it.
That scene actually is interesting that you point out, because that was something that we had been talking about, and I think originally we were going to, Eddie and I were going to be in the scene together in this hotel room, counting money and being excited. And then Greg, at the last minute, was like, no, let's have her count the money. And that was something that I was like, okay, you're giving me my power as this character. And I thought that was really special, you know, and that in kind of like this montage-y, like, on the road type device, you see, it's quick, yeah. That she, like, makes it happen for herself. And I remember at first being like, is that too quick? But I think that's actually who she was, you know what I mean? And I think that's what makes that first scene so powerful, is that he sees her. She had all that stuff in her, mm-hmm. And, you know, and she just needed a person to remind her of that and to bear witness to her. And it's really beautiful that it actually is a man and that it's not a sexual thing. You know what I mean? That he truly doesn't have a motive but besides wanting to see a sister win, you know? And that to me, I was like, oh wow, okay. And so in regards to the journey, I think a lot of it just had to do with Eddie and I in the moment, to be honest. I always had this feeling like this scene could be anything, kind of. Like, it just depends on what they end up chopping together, you know what I mean, in the editing room, or what direction Craig wants to go in. But I think that's a very freeing experience, you know, as an actor, when you really feel as though you have a counterpart where it's like, I trust you, you trust me, and let's just ride with it. Where there's endless possibilities. I think for some people that can be very scary, and I think what was fortunate that it was very thrilling and exciting for us. I think I can speak for him in that regard. And so, to be honest, when I watched the movie, that's then when I was like, oh wow, this is where it went. You know what I mean? Because if I'm being really honest, I didn't know it while we were doing it. I knew what the scene was. I knew the objectives and the goals and what we're trying to obtain scene to scene. But to see how it all came together and that they're able to have this true bond and intimacy, especially during that time period where it isn't over-sexualized or where the woman isn't, you know, objectified by her physique, and it can truly just be two people who really support each other, a real support system. And so,
a real friend.
Yeah, truly. And like an authentic one without motives. And that's rare, especially in the industry.
Would have been Norma Hill.
No. Mona's up the wazoo. But, but it was so...
Maybe you dress wrong for the money scene.
Yeah, exactly. You're going to be naked in a bed. So it was really nice to have the trust of Craig and to have... You know, it was just really... I think something that was really amazing is that, you know, people talk about Eddie taking a break or he retired. I don't know. The man just took some time. Like, he's been working for y'all for a very, very long time.
He was doing other things.
And so what was nice is I am coming, how having this be a project fresh off of him taking that break, I found, you guys have known him and more personally, but what I found is it was as if it was his first time in regards to like the freshness and the newness and the excitement and true passion and desire, you know? So I wasn't confronted with any ego. It literally felt like me and this other guy, we're doing this movie and we're both really excited and all the quote unquote Eddie Murphy stuff that you would think could be a part of it wasn't there. You know, and that we were truly happy and excited to be there. We were upset when we weren't called to work and we would come to work on our days off and be in Video Village supporting one another. Like, it was authentic. Cause I don't think that's, all that common. You enjoy your days off and you might like one or two people in the show. You know what I mean? But when it's authentic, like head to toe, everyone just really, kind of like how the movie is, like really, really rallying for one another and being like supportive and being like.
I wasn't sure you liked me when we first met.
Stop it. I loved you.
I don't know. You just seem to have a little thing with Keenan though.
I was nervous.
You used to sit there and used to watch, look at Keenan like.
That was I was nervous.
Like, look at how I'm looking at Keenan like that.
Yeah, I was nervous. Because I was like, that's Wesley Snipes.
You're one of them.
Are you kidding? I was like, that's Wesley Snipes. But no, it was really special. So it was kind of a lovely gift and surprise when I saw the movie. Because I didn't know, I was just focused in the moment and in the now. So I can't really take credit for like the arc of it. Like I just focused on, for the time being, this is what it is.
Mm-hmm. Wesley, to wrap up, one of the things I also love about Dribble is that he's sort of in his own world. We associate with
you. He's ghetto fabulous.
As much as we associate with Ruby and everybody else, Dribble suddenly is sort of the club. You go, oh right, this is how most people would look at this situation. Like kind of looking like, these guys are crazy or whatever. Like there's a level to him that you sort of have.
Something sober.
Right.
When he wasn't sober.
Exactly, it's a very interesting sort of tightrope walk, right? That he's both our eyes into it, and then also sort of this guy who's on the outside of it, right?
True, because at the end of the day, he doesn't want to lose the moment.
Right.
He sees in the moment, even if it's crazy and ludicrous. Right. You never know what's going to happen. And then he ends up doing a film with Fred Williams, so he works out.
That's right. Well, the whole film was fantastic. Thank you all so much for being here. Ladies and gentlemen.